Good morning. We begin with breaking news. There's been a big court win for the maker of flushable wipes, Kimberly Clark. Live to Kelly Fedor at Federal Court. Kelly, what's happened there this morning?
Well, Sophie, this was described as a world first case, and today the federal court came down in favour of Kimberly Clark. The ACCC, our consumer watchdog, had taken the company to court over its flushable wipes, claiming they did not disintegrate properly and were causing blockages in our water system. They spend more than $1 million every year cleaning out such blockages. But today Justice Gleeson said that those claims of damage had not been substantiated in court through a plumber or through consumers. She said even if they had, the number of complaints in relation to the millions of wipes sold was insignificant. She also said that the company had endeavoured to comply with some international guidelines. She ordered the consumer watchdog pay the company's court costs. Many stakeholders in this have described this decision as disappointing. Choice has released a statement saying it's terrible news. They're urging Australians not to flush wipes down our toilets regardless of this court decision. Sophie?
And Kelly, thanks for the update there. A cyber stalker who imitated actor Lincoln Lewis online to threaten and torment other women has faced court in Melbourne. Live to Eliza Rugg for the latest. Eliza, a bizarre situation outside court.
Yes, Sophie, quite ugly scenes outside the county court in Melbourne this morning. 29-year-old Lydia Abdel-Malik, she is known as the Catfish Woman, and she was in court this morning to appeal her 2-year and 8-month prison sentence. She was cyber-stalking a number of innocent women online. She managed to lure them into fake online relationships while pretending to be TV actor Lincoln Lewis. She tormented these women and their families. One of the victims even ended up taking her own life, but Abdel-Malik has never shown any remorse. In fact, she says she's innocent. She is appealing her jail term. That appeal hearing is now set down for October next year because of court delays. Her father became quite aggressive to the media outside court. Lydia, on what grounds are you appealing your jail term?
Do you have any apologies to your victims? Will you find more victims?
So Abdel-Malik remains on bail. She does have social media restrictions to stop her finding any more victims. Prosecutors have vowed that they will call more witnesses at her appeal hearing next year to make sure her conviction remains secure. Sophie.
Eliza, thanks for the update there from Melbourne. Our Prime Minister has used his first meeting with Donald Trump to plead with the US President to end the trade war with China. Live 2 political reporter Chris O'Keefe in Canberra. Chris, how did that go down?
Well, it was really a bit of a love-in, Sophie. President Trump and Prime Minister Morrison sat down for that working dinner last night to discuss the list of things. But at the top, as you said, was this trade war with China. Now, Scott Morrison said it was important both the president and Xi Jinping of China came to an agreement to stop the world from slipping into a recession, and that would ultimately affect Australia. But other than that, the two leaders spoke about our deep military ties forged over almost 100 years and the developing situations in both Iran and North Korea. But when it comes to Scott Morrison's shock election win, Mr. Trump said he wasn't surprised at all.
So I said, he's going to do very well. And he did. He did. They called it an upset, but I don't call it an upset. You probably didn't. Your wife didn't call it an upset.
Well, I'm sure the Prime Minister was pretty chuffed at that. But when it came to the trade war with China, Scott Morrison has said that he worries about other smaller countries like Australia becoming collateral damage. And while Donald Trump will ultimately make the call on what suits America best, it's interesting that Australia has not been granted a similar meeting with China at the G20. Our political editor, Chris Yeoman, asked the Prime Minister about this on The Today Show.
Xi Jinping is the other important president, yet you're not having a meeting with him. Is China giving us the cold shoulder?
No, I wouldn't say that. I mean, there'll be other meetings towards the end of this year. There's the East Asia Summit, there's APEC. At these meetings, you also do actually get the opportunity to pull aside and have chats. 1 in 5 jobs in Australia is dependent on trade. We've never got rich selling things to ourselves. I mean, it's always been about engaging the rest of the world.
So the big meeting that everyone is waiting for between Donald Trump and President Xi, the trillion-dollar handshake, as they are calling it, is on for tomorrow. And the world's markets and leaders are waiting to see if this trade war can be resolved. But Sophie, some other news. Donald Trump has also been invited to come to Australia at the end of the year for the President's Cup Golf. It's in Melbourne, and he said, while it could be a bit hard with his schedule, he'd very much like to.
Yeah, there's a real bromance flourishing between Trump and ScoMo, isn't there? Thanks, Chris. Well, the wife of a Perth man missing in North Korea last heard from him on Monday. Alex Sigley's wife said she's worried because he hasn't been in touch, but reiterated, we don't know anything yet. Japan's Prime Minister Shinzo Abe raised Sigley's disappearance with Scott Morrison after a Japanese sushi chef has also gone missing in Pyongyang.
It's obviously very concerning. I'm very concerned about it. We've had a lot of sympathy also expressed and willingness to assist by other countries.
Mr. Sigley runs a tour company and is studying in North Korea. The Department of Foreign Affairs is working with the Swedish embassy in Pyongyang to make contact with him. A Brisbane CrossFit gym has been sprayed with bullets in an early morning shooting, police describing it as a clearly targeted attack. Jessica Millwood reports.
Well, detectives continue their investigations into this after the CrossFit in Woolloongabba was shot at around 2:30 this morning. 10 gunshots going through the window and also the door. Thankfully, no one was inside, so no one was injured at the time, but locals heard those gunshots and a car speeding away. Detectives are searching for CCTV in the area to try and get a good description of that vehicle. People were being turned away from the CrossFit this morning. However, classes will go on for the rest of the day in a separate part of the building. I've spoken to the woman that heard the gunshots and the car. Here's what she had to tell me.
This is just like totally not something that I would ever have expected to happen around here.
A motive is not yet known, but police do believe that the CrossFit was specifically targeted given that no other business or property in the area was shot at. Anyone who hasn't yet spoken to police and has some information on this, well, they're being asked to call Crime Stoppers.
Police in New South Wales have announced a $1 million reward to help solve the cold case murder of a 17-year-old girl more than 40 years ago. For more on this, let's go live to reporter Mark Burrows. Mark, why have police reopened their investigation into Bronwyn Richardson's disappearance?
Well, Sophie, I think for police this has been an incredibly frustrating case. It's come to court twice and both times the case has fallen over. It is one of the oldest cold cases in New South Wales. Bronwyn disappeared on a night in 1973. She was taken to an area near the Murray River where she was killed. Her body was found in the river. Now, in the years that followed, three people were charged, but as I say, the case never resulted in a conviction. Another person was charged with murder, Bronwyn's murder, back in 2014. And again, that case fell over before it actually came to court. Well, police do believe they know who committed this murder, and they're now offering a $1 million reward for anybody who has that critical extra evidence to come forward. Today, Bronwyn's sister, Fiona, came forward and urged people to come forward, claim that reward and give that evidence. Here's Fiona.
The impact has destroyed our family and it took a huge toll on both of my parents. We grieve daily for Bronnie and for the life that she never got to live.
Now, police say they are very close to cracking this this murder case, but they need that critical evidence. They know someone is out there and they believe those people do have that evidence that could bring forward a murder charge and ultimately a conviction. Fiona says the family have vowed to never put rest in peace on Bronwyn's headstone until there is a conviction. Soph.
Mark, thank you for the update. Well, talks between Rugby Australia and Israel Folau are now underway, but the prospect of a settlement between the two seems unlikely. Damien Ryan is live for us at the Fair Work Commission. Damo, it was game on this morning. Talk us through what happens.
Yes, certainly. So if this is long-awaited showdown between Israel Folau and Rugby Australia at the Fair Work Commission. Israel Folau walked into a huge media scrum when he arrived, but he was also flanked by a posse of well-paid lawyers. And, of course, he can afford them thanks to his successful fundraising over the past couple of days, which saw him bank $2 million. Now, he will argue that Rugby Australia had no legal grounds to sack him over that controversial post, which said that homosexuals and adulterers and others should be banished to hell. Now, Folau muddled just a few words when he walked into court this morning, or to this hearing this morning, but earlier on he'd telegraphed his demands in a post on YouTube.
First and foremost, I'm hoping for an apology from Rugby Australia and an acknowledgement that even if they disagree with my views, I should be free to peacefully express my religious beliefs without fear of retribution or exclusion.
Now, Rugby Australia's Raylene Castle is also involved in these conciliatory talks, but she arrived in a furious mood after comments Israel Folau made last night in a TV interview, which he claimed that he'd been offered cash by Rugby Australia to delete that post. Raylene Castle says that is completely untrue. As you mentioned, these talks are continuing behind closed doors, but the real distinct possibility here is that there'll be no breakthrough today in this matter. Is definitely headed to the federal court. Sophie?
Damo, thank you.